you can't buy a pair of underwear. I think that's true. So everyone spends their time going to Tuolumne County or Amador County or San Joaquin County because there's nothing in this county to be had. So I think that it's wrong to say that Larry Cope is encouraging Calaveras County to join this grant. What I also see, and what I've heard from a few other sources on the board here, is there appears to be a nexus that the county is running out of money and having problems in a variety of areas, and this grant appears to be some sort of silver bullet to solve the problem. You know, the fact that the county has wasted well over $1 million on a general plan update that is in trouble right now, and you're looking for money to complete this general plan update using grant money, says something about the administration of the general plan update. So I think we need to take a look at all the options and what we're really trying to accomplish and see if the strings attached with this grant are worth the money that we're going to get. And if we're going to get the bang for our buck that Tuolumne County or Amador County may get out of these funds. But I just wanted to make a point that I know Larry Cope, and I think it would be best if he addressed the board and the public about what his feelings are as far as the benefit of Calaveras County entering into this grant. Thank you.
Melissa, did you have something? Mr. Reese, did you have something you wanted to add to this that has not been said before?
Yes, I have a couple of questions.
Then could you please come up and address the board?
No problem.
Thank you.
I did not see or find what is going to cost the county to prepare this application. I just see no numbers. That's one thing.
Okay.
I noticed that it's supposed to be what? Amador, Tuolumne, and Calaveras County. What happened to Amador? Is Amador still active in this thing, or they bowed out, or what?
Okay,
does anybody
thank
know?
Thank you. Mr. Dave, could you please come up and address that? Thank you.
Sorry. Amador County is in exact same place we are today. They're addressing their board seeking permission to move forward.
And one more question.
Wait. There was the dollars, what it, the cost of our participation might be?
Well, the cost in preparing the grant application or the cost once if we got awarded and actually...
No, I just want you to know how much we're going to pay you to prepare this thing to apply for the grant.
So far, I've put maybe a half a day in, and that we have to have the application done by the end of this week to meet the board's schedules to get it on agendas, and so it'd be really the rest of today and tomorrow.
Dollar figures. You got sympathy.
Yeah, I'm not sure what the dollar figures would be.
Okay, thank you, sir.
You know, 10 hours, 12 hours of a planner's time.
Okay. And one more question to you, sir. Did you prepare the rim situation in Valley Spring?
No.
Yeah, man, you're not the father of it. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Reeves.
Lucky deal there.
Yes.
I was just hoping to add a bit of information about the in-kind or the match question that we had. In Tuolumne County, the Board of Supervisors approved the SAP time to develop the application, the very same thing we're here today. But they did say that one sort of string that they would tie to that is that if we did receive funding, they didn't want any general fund monies to be attributed to that time. So we're incorporating staff time into the grant to cover that. If there are match amounts that will be attributed, we're looking at those amounts coming from the TCTC, and we're currently utilizing $60,000 that the TCTC has received for blueprint funding to leverage that amount with this grant. But that one speculation was made by the Board of Supervisors at the time.
Okay, we have something similar to that. Thank you. If there's no other comments on this item, I'm going to bring it back to the board for any comments or action. Supervisor Tryon, are there any comments you want to make on this?
Okay, I'll give my comments. First of all, it's always nice to see all my Tea Party friends in the audience when an issue like this comes forward. One individual that spoke, I don't know if it was a board or it was a public comment, made the comment, though, well, geez, this was a grant voted on by the people, and therefore it has the support of the people. But if you read the grant was the safe drinking water, water quality and supply flood control, river and coastal protection bond act of 2006. It didn't talk anything about the implementation of AB 32 or SB 375. Mr. McManus pointed out in the addendum, it goes a long way from what the title of the Bond Act would give a rational person an idea of what the heck they were voting on. And one of the reasons we have, in my opinion, so many unintended consequences to bond acts is because the absolute fraudulent nature of the title that goes with the bond. But let's get into to what's happening here. I mean, this is not, as some people say, oh, well, you got to look at the strings attached, as the gentleman from my district that worked for the school district said, these aren't strings attached. This is basically how the law is being implemented. And if we don't implement it, then they will come after us and force us to implement it. Steve talks about, oh, well, look at all the local initiative and local control. I would submit that that's not going to happen at all. Maybe that might be a selling point at this point in time. But they will be implemented basically through the environmental community, through the courts that will sue and say that we haven't met the conditions of the strings, and therefore the development projects need to be halted, or the general plan will be deficient, or you can just go down. We know how this stuff gets implemented. The whole environmental agenda doesn't get implemented at the local board of supervisors. It gets implemented at the court level. I guess I could go on a long time on these matters. I mean, if I were in the state legislature, I would be a very strong and vocal advocate of not suspending but abolishing both SB or AB 32 and SB 375 and the whole cap and trade. And, you know, it's happening at the national level. It's happening at the state level. California wants to be in front of the national wave, et cetera, and we aren't going to change any of this, quite frankly, unless we get a change in political leadership at both the state and the national level. I would like to just talk briefly on Mr. Williams' sort of comments about children. It always sort of gets me when people sort of stand up and governmental people stand up and talk about the children. First off, the children, you know, are rightfully under the control of parents and family, not government. And you know, we're already straddling our children and our grandchildren with massive government debt. This spending and this grant and this bond is just more government debt that the children will pay for. Government, by its very nature, enforces conformity, not diversity. Marketplaces allow for diversity, not government. And when you have an elite group of people that are basically going to impose a particular agenda or living arrangement or whatever, and they call it smart growth, then what's getting described by the government is basically a sort of a utopian a better way to live. Turns out, in my opinion, most times when you see government imposing utopia, it turns out to be a living hell because it does away with individual choice. In economics, we talk a lot about methodological individualism, because it's about individual choices. In other words, if the government came in and gave everybody in here $1 million and said you have to spend it by the end of the year, and you can't spend more than, say, $5,000 on any one item, we wouldn't have anybody in here that would have the same spending habits. We would all have different choices. But government doesn't allow choice. Government's about conformity. And all this planning is basically about of conformity, and that's what government imposes. And if you don't agree with the conformity, then you violate the law, and you will suffer either civil and or criminal penalties. The grant before us, having said all that, I will vote for the grant before us, because I don't think we have any choice. Either we are going to do this either by spending county general fund money, or we are going to do it through this grant. Those are the two choices available to the county. If we do it through county general fund monies, then either your taxes have to go up, or your fees have to go up, or something's going to have to go up to pay for it. It's not a free lunch. You don't get to reject this, and this just goes away. That's not, you know, we're not the school system. You can either accept it or reject it. We're going to get this imposed, and this is the way it's being imposed at this time, and this is the carrot. If we don't accept the carrot, we will get the stick, and it's not a choice, in my opinion. It's a bad choice, and it's not about the individuals. You can go out in our communities and look at the houses, and we all have different architects, we all have different designs, we all have different everything, because we're individuals. But that's not what government's going to do, and there will be continuous war on cars or vehicles or the internal combustion engine or whatever the heck the government wants to wage war on, or the environmental community through the government wishes to wage war against the citizens and the individuals who have different choices. I will vote for the grant because I feel I have no choice but to vote for the grant. But this November, I will certainly be trying to pick candidates that will not be imposing these kinds of mandates. So that concludes my comments.
Thank you. Mr. Walensky.
Well, I'd like to start with the George Washington quote that Tanya delivered, because I think it's a good point of departure for this discussion. George Washington said that, I'm not quoting word for word because I don't have it in front of me, but my read of that quote was that property rights are pretty darn important. So long as they don't impinge upon or ruin other people's property rights. That's the basic principle that we had in founding this country. There was a lot of debate about whether property rights should be supreme over all other rights. For instance, do you get property rights and that's what guarantees you the franchise? Well, they decided no. That was a lost issue in the early constitutional arguments. The question is, how do we wind up having individual property rights harm other rights? And in my view, the worst example in California of the supremacy of property rights over community interest and each other's property rights is probably Los Angeles. To me, that's an unlivable place. It's a place where a lot of people come from to move into the foothills down there and to some extent up here. You could say the same thing to a lesser extent about the Bay Area. They develop communities that ultimately are unlivable. Many of the people in this room came from those communities because they were unlivable. They were dangerous. There were not jobs there, or if there were, they were lousy. You can't get to work because you're sitting on a freeway all day long and you're breathing stuff that no human being ought to have to breathe. We get cancers. I don't know how many people in this room either have had cancer or have their friends or family or loved ones suffer cancer. In my family, we've had a lot of losses. I think it has something to do with what we breathe. I think it has something to do with our exercise of property rights to the point where it actually winds up with collective nightmares that make this an unhealthy place to live. Now, we've all come to a place that is relatively healthy. The question is, can we manage ourselves in such a way that can reconcile people's rights, which are critically important? George Washington was right. You don't trample on other people. But at the same time, you make sure that we are considerate and careful with one another. Now, we've had a lot of debates and arguments over that basic issue, and there are different tendencies, and this room is full of many of those. But for my way of thinking, the global issues here that people have raised are important. How we determine, let me give you some zoning examples. We all talk about how come Tuolumne's got all the jobs? How come we're shopping for underwear far, far away? What did McManus has a point. We've got a serious problem here in Calaveras. Well, doesn't zoning have something to do when we don't have a place for industrial development or where serious commercial endeavor, where we define the places that are best for that? Doesn't that make some sense that we figure that out? And doesn't it make a big difference for us if we live, work, shop, and recreate and get our food from places that are not so far away? It is a global issue because in this country we've spent, I don't know how many people have checked out the coast, but as we drill deeper and deeper and beyond sometimes our technological capabilities, or as we try to spend a lot of time and sacrifice a lot of life in a place that without oil would be just a pile of sand and a bunch of, you know, tribes. The fact that we spend so much of our treasure, so much of our resource in figuring out how to sustain essentially a bad plan is beyond me. And we are better than that in this county. The question ultimately to me is, can we control some of these outcomes? I was very dismayed at what happened in Valley Springs and the way the processes went and the way that people did not feel included in an early process and wound up feeling left out and oppositional as a result. Can we do this differently? Well, I see several possibilities in that. Number one, the agencies that we would be dealing with have no regulatory authority, as I said before, and have proven themselves throughout the Sierra as supporting the people of the Sierra in participation in process. Secondly, it's up to us what we apply for. And thirdly, it's up to us how we administer this. And I think that has to be written into any application that would then come to the board that would require my approval. So I'm hoping people are taking a look at the lessons we've learned and the reactions to those lessons and build in community process that's inclusive, that involves genuine property owners and business participation, along with environmental and many other concerns, and that we manage this process learning lessons of the past in the same way that this species of ours needs to learn some lessons from the history of how we've managed to bring this planet to a serious moment of reckoning. I don't want to lose any more kids to a war that involves a place that has no meaning to us if it weren't for its resources. And I want to take our resources here as we're looking at Calaveras County. We have tremendous resources. We have the ability to develop economies that get us back in the forest, both federal and our own lands, to restore some of the damage and mess that we've created. Look at what we did by not doing anything for the last 50 years on BLM lands surrounding the towns in my district. We're ready to burn. We could put lots of people back to work dealing with that. We already have people. There's three crews out today doing the first community wildfire protection plan, implementing those first ones in Calaveras history. Now, I'd like to see that gin up to a serious economic theory that would develop both our response to AB 32, albeit imposed, but it gives us an opportunity here to put a lot of people back to work. AB 32 is we can contribute to the intent of it by keeping our forests from burning, and by the way, keeping ourselves from burning in the process. One town in my community doesn't exist anymore because we didn't do that. Ask where people in Frico City live today. It's not in Frico City. It burned down. Now, I got towns of West Point, Wilseyville, Glencoe, Railroad Flat, Mountain Ranch, Sheep Ranch, all ready to torch with a fuel buildup that is profound. I'm hoping this thing will develop plans that will improve our approach to this. Not imposing things. I'd like to see it involve federal, and I'd like to see the feds step up and take responsibility for their lands. I'd like to see us have plans to participate in restoring and being good stewards of that, because we're better stewards than anything that's ever come from outside this area. You can tell by the ranchers and the people who have long been good stewards in this land for a long, long time. But if we don't address these things, then shame on us. And if we don't get assistance when we can, where are the resources going to come from? I, for different reasons than Tom, will support this. But I also think that it would be much healthier if we were able to have these conversations, develop an economic theory. This talks about, and this is one of the goals, development of a central Sierra business climate development strategy. Well, I'm for that. But I want the right people in the room, and I want a process that's fair and reasonable and inclusive to be able to move forward on those areas we can agree on. We're trying very hard in the forested areas of this county to do something of this nature. My hope is that there will be other economic theories that can be more comprehensive. I want to find zoning for industrial in this county. I want to see whether there's places where we can develop the kinds of retail economies that people are seeking here. How we do that without angering one another is a pretty darn tough task these days, especially with the political climate in the county. And that leads me to one last comment. People talk about momentum. Pendulum swings, I believe, was the word. I think our obligation is, regardless of what direction the pendulum is swinging on a particular day, is to try to get the thing right, to try to take the public interest and George Washington's balance of how we're able to have our property rights intact and at the same time not harm other people. And how we figure that out together, because that's the only way we'll figure it out, is the task before us. I would encourage a process and funding toward that end, but I'd sure hate to see us repeat the sad process that we've just been through in Valley Springs. And I would certainly suggest to the department that if and when it proposes a grant, that it includes something that really is, I use this word at great peril, a robust and inclusive community process.
Mr. Toffanelli.
Sustainable Communities Planning Grant is funded by Prop 84, the Safe Drinking Water, Water Quality and Supply, Flood Control, River and Coastal Protection Bond Act. How you can get sustainable community planning grants out of that, I have no idea. Sustainable community planning, in my opinion, I've lived through it down in Valley Springs. There's going to be strings attached to it. I don't care what you say, how we can administrate it or what. The problem that you have is you can get public input from it, but it's all going to be channeled into one outcome. That's what the sustainable communities planning is about. That's what the uproar in my community was about. People weren't being heard. The only people that were being heard was the predetermined outcome. It had to be channeled into one specific outcome, smart growth. This is the same thing. I don't care how you say it. I don't care how you address it. I don't care how you look at it. It's going in the same direction. Anytime I see sustainable community planning, it's the same thing. I cannot vote for this. I won't vote for this. I cannot look at this and see a bait and switch, how a bond was sold to the people and there's certain ideas that it was going to be used for, and now it's being turned and being used for increased housing affordability, increased infill and compact development, promote equity, protect natural resources and agricultural lands. You might get something out of that as far as the water quality. Reduce automobile usage and fuel consumption. Improve infrastructure systems. Revitalize community centers and strengthen the economy. I'm sure Prop 84, none of that verbiage was used in selling this to the public. Therefore, it has to have strings attached to it. Just that, those verbiage and the things that's being said right there, there's no way that this thing could be administered fully from the county without guidelines and strings and a predetermined outcome, no matter how you use it. So I cannot and will not vote for this.
Mr. Thomas.
I don't have Supervisor Toffanelli's skepticism about this, the phrase sustainable. I don't look at that word and as it when it's linked to sustainable economic conditions. What I see is a worthwhile objective, is I visualize that as a worthwhile objective rather than some sort of linking to a worldwide anti-property rights movement. I just don't see it. I have spent my life trying to be a public servant. And when I hear this I don't know, what I would classify as a kind of an intimidation factor, that the references to the pendulum and being on the right side of the pendulum and you know, this is a blatant attempt to turn me into a politician, which I am not. If I were directly responsive to those threats and intimidation and confrontational types of activities, then I would become the politician that all of you seem to hate. I think that is very paradoxical and inconsistent with some of the things that I hear you wanting, or the population wants our elected officials to be. Less political and politicians and more public servants. I'm going to vote for this because I want very desperately to be a responsive public citizen. I've got to look at myself in the mirror each and every morning and answer the question, am I doing the job to the best of my ability to represent the present and future residents of this county? As to Mr. McManus's his conclusion that I was suggesting that Mr. Cope, Larry Cope, was suggesting that Calaveras County somehow jump on the bandwagon. Well, that wasn't my objective. I was saying that there seems to be some sort of an inconsistency where, on one hand, we are repeatedly being asked, and I am on the same side of this bandwagon, is that this county should do its level best to imitate the successes that have been achieved in Tuolumne County, both Tuolumne County and Amador County. And I think that this is another thing that I'm anxious to do. If they're leading the charge to get involved in this so that we can achieve some economic benefits from this, and then I want to follow their example, like we've been asked to do, like you, Bill, have asked us recently to do. Let's be more like Tuolumne County. So that's one of the reasons that I'm going to vote for this. I want to make it very, very clear that I absolutely hate AB 32. I can't stand it, and I've said repeatedly here that it will be probably the death knell of this state. I've talked about examples of men and women that I've seen that have trucks that they're going to have to park soon because of the stupid rules of AB 32. I can't stand it. It's an affront to my background and my sensibilities. I absolutely hate it that we're using AB 32 rules and regulations to force us to buy $400,000 tractors that I don't think that we need. So I'm not giving up my placard that I want to wave that we should down with AB 32 and voting for this. No, make no mistake about that. I think that I'm very much in, not lockstep necessarily, but I identify completely with Tom Tryon's suggestion that this is it's a necessary position to take. It's the prudent step to take. So I will be supporting this. And lastly, I am doing this specifically so that I will not become a politician. Thank you.
Mr. Walensky, you had another comment.
Yes, I'm sorry. I neglected to mention one thing which Gary had raised, which is what, and Tom as well, what's the nexus between Prop 84 and the issues of climate and air quality? If you take a look at the Sierra, and this is something that there are a number of different state agencies that are responsible for analyzing this, but the Sierra Nevada Conservancy spent a great deal of time looking at the state of the Sierra, that the situation with its forests, the fact that we spent $900 million last year on wildfire suppression, the fact that the forests are no longer resilient because they've grown up in even-aged single-species plantations with no maintenance over the last 30 to 50 years. The conditions of our forests became an issue for water and climate and air quality. You can tell it's affecting air quality because every summer around here we breathe the results of forest burning throughout California. In fact, we even get smoke from the Southern California fires at times all the way through the valley and into the foothills. You can tell how it affects water when the forests around watersheds burn because the silt, which quickly in the runoff, which quickly fills the rivers, affects both water quality, but also, in the end, the life of the dams that create the reservoirs that people downstream rely on for their survival. The problem is when they fill up with silt, we then are forced to either raise dams for billions of dollars, or we can do prevention and put people back to work in trying to restore and sustain forests. That's the thinking. That's the nexus between air quality, water quantity and quality, and what we're and what some of this, not all, but if we were to devise something that is county specific that really serves our interests, it would be in responding to them that we like offsets. When we take care of the forest for the rest of California, we'd like to see our ability to create development and the kinds of services and economies locally. There is a nexus. It takes a little bit of thinking outside of each individual department's views. It's not just about child care or our children. It's not just about air quality. It's not just about if we keep in compartmentalizing these things and don't think of the Sierra as a whole and don't recognize when forests burn, a lot happens in other areas, then we'll never get credit where it's due. We'll never have the work that we do here count in relation to these, what some people are calling onerous regulations, but we can do things that would be good for us and still meet compliance. And that's the kind of thing I'm hoping that this department will go after. It's not about fitting to their view of it. It's making the rest of California take a look at the Sierra and how we develop ourselves in a way that is, well, nobody likes the word sustainable, but let's say something we can live with for a few generations instead of just what seems to be occurring up here, which is ready to burn.
I got to rebut that a little bit because it was a rebuttal to what I had to say as far as I'm concerned. And this is what they're applying for is not to fix the Sierra, Steve. That's not what they're asking for. So sit here on a platform and talk about fixing the Sierra is one thing, but that's not what they were asking for the grant to be. You're going off on something that I brought up during my comment period was, about trying to run a nexus between air quality and water quality. There's no mention on the passage of this bond 84, Prop 84 bond money, about the air quality affecting the water quality of it. You're running a nexus of what you've learned through your Sierra Nevada Conservancy time on that committee. That's not what we're discussing here. We were discussing here what planning department was asking for, and that was for the zoning, for this grant applied for the zoning changes and the general plan update, and what was the other thing that they were asking for?
Greenhouse gas.
is AB 32. So, you know, that's my comments, my rebuttal back.
I would like to make just one additional comment. What I gave was my reason. The reasons I gave were sort of my first reason for saying I'll vote for the grant, because I think it's going to happen. It's just a question: is it general fund money or is it grant money? If I thought for a minute that if we voted against this grant, the issue would go away, I'd be right where Gary is. But I don't believe that. A second reason I'm in favor of this, quite frankly, is. If the board doesn't do this through the planning department, in my opinion, you will see the COG get a grant to do exactly this, and this will be done through the COG. And that's the last place I want this done, is in the COG. I don't want the COG doing the climate action plan. I don't want them doing the infill plan. They won't do the zoning code update, but they will do everything else just like they've done previously and then hand it to the county. I don't want the COG in any way associated this. I want it kept in the county, and I want it to be administered by the county planning department. I want the public hearings before the board of supervisors, and I think this elected body up here, which is in fact elected and represents the unincorporated area of the county, should be the party that makes the decisions, and we should be held accountable for those decisions. And to me, that's a very strong second reason to vote for the grant at this level rather than letting it, because to me, it will automatically go to, in my opinion, almost automatically go to the COG. Secondly, the county's population, someone correct me if I'm in error here, is around 45,000. When we reach 50,000, for those of you that were not here when we had the COG study session, I believe, a week or two ago, once we hit 50,000, we automatically go to, in the designation of the state, to a metropolitan planning organization.
Tom, we don't. It's when a city does, not the county.
I thought it was when the county did.
No,
actually, it was misrepresented to this board, but it,
okay.
The truth of it is that it's when a city crosses it.
It's 200,000 for the county.
We'll have to be
that was misrepresented then. But MPOs, just so you understand where this is going and the reason for my first course of action, metropolitan planning organizations under the law have to implement SB 375 now. It's not an option. The COG executive director would very much like the COG to implement SB 375 today, and that the COG should be moving itself and the county and the city towards the implementation of 375. And if you took this before, in my opinion anyway, before the COG governing board, you would find that, in my opinion, you would most likely find that governing board is all in favor of AB 32 and all in favor of SB 375. So I guess if I wanted to amend my statement earlier about we have to change political leadership at the state and the national level, there's probably some looking at the local level, quite frankly, also. I'd like to just end with one sort of comment on Steve's comments. First off, it has nothing to do with forests, but if you look at even Steve's argument, what we're looking at is horribly failed environmental policies that have been advocated by the environmental community and implemented by the courts. When you look at the United States forest policy. So you can look at a lot of the things that the environmental community has advocated that have had disastrous results, even for the children. And, you know, why are we now buying lock, stock, and barrel of the economic argument even further of how we should live, not only economically, but even our civil liberties and our social choices are just becoming more and more under the control of government. At some level of government. So I think it's hard to point to the environmental organization's failures as a reason to implement AB 32 or SB 375. That concludes my comments.
Does any other board member have any comments they'd like to make?
I have one comment addressing Tom's comment about COG. Tom, don't you sit on the COG board?
Yes, I do.
So you're in favor of AB 32?
Well, Rick County and I are
the
lone voices on the COG board.
Wait a minute. You said they were all in favor of SB 32.
Well, a majority are. Not all. A majority. Excuse me. Let me just say a majority would pass AB 32 and SB 375, in my opinion.
Thank you for clarifying that.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you for asking. I wouldn't want that to stand.
Well, I'll get it out. All right, so it's my turn. One, we've taken a red flag word, which is sustainable, and made something bigger out of it than it needs. This is a very narrowly focused grant application. One, it's Tri-County. At least two to possibly three counties. And we're always talking about working in partnership. We already have to do greenhouse gas on our projects. That's done through the CEQA process. So let's just don't pretend it doesn't exist and that we're not doing it, because we are. So we, one, have that opportunity to work with the Tri-Counties, or at least because we don't know how Amador is going to go, but with Tuolumne and Calaveras. So we keep talking about doing things with our adjoining neighbors. Here's an opportunity. And mostly, it's very clear what it is that the Calaveras funds will be used for, which would be comprehensive zoning ordinance update, which we have to do. As Tom said, if we don't do it through this process, then it's going to be funded through the general plan. I mean, excuse me, the general fund. So we keep asking staff, please find opportunities to fund things other than using general fund money. Staff has found a way to do it, and we should be acknowledging what they've done and supporting what they've done, because they're doing exactly what we've asked them to do. I mean, everybody's very concerned about grants, but if it wasn't for grants, we probably wouldn't have as much of the Sheriff's Department projects as we have. And I just happen to be thinking about Marine Safety, Narcotics Unit, all of that's grant funding. Environmental Health used grant funding for mosquito abatement when we had real issues with the West Nile virus. Public Health has used grant funding for inoculations. Motherlode Job Connection has used grant funding to train residents of Calaveras County. The libraries use grant fundings for computers for our library. So, I mean, we look at these things and we think there's going to be a lot of strings. There are strings, because a grant is applied for a specific purpose. When we talk about zoning, I had the opportunity recently to work with a group of people in the Ebbets Pass corridor in changing their land use designation, because their land use designation is very restrictive. So in the process of doing the general plan, we're going to be changing their land use designation, which will increase the opportunities that they have to do things on their property. So it isn't, everything isn't negative. There's no hidden agendas here. What the staff is asking us to do is to approve applying for a grant application, and we've already spent, I don't know how much time, an hour and a half, and this is just applying for it. We haven't even seen the details yet. I mean, we should be thanking them for finding a mechanism to fund work that we have to do that will not come from the general fund. I mean, it's very narrow in scope, and I think pretty much everything has been said. So If there's no further comment from the board, which I don't think I will take, I will entertain a motion.
I'll move the item, please.
I'll second the motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
District 1 votes no.
Yeah. Gary Toffanelli votes no. Since not everybody knows what districts are what. So Supervisor Toffanelli voted no. Thank you.
Christ, that's great.
I'd like to take a
Madam Chair,
break.
Madam Chair, I'd like to ask a question about 10 to 12 now. What is our intended, what are we going to do about the rest of the agenda?
We're going to proceed.
Proceed, okay. Ten-minute break.
Mm-hmm. A five-minute break. Do you need 10 minutes?
No.
Let's just go to lunch.
Thank you. I'd like to move to item 8 on the new agenda, a resolution authorizing professional services agreement. Mr. Garcia.
Thank you, Chair Calloway. This is an agreement between David Evans and Associates and Calaveras County to provide consultant services for Mountain Ranch Road improvements, jail access, and government center circulation plan. Public Works has been working with the Sheriff's Office, the CAO's office, and the jail consultants on the jail access, Mountain Ranch Road improvements, and the circulation around government center. As directed by the board, Public Works issued a request for proposals for these tasks and received 10 proposals. After review, a committee made up of staff from Public Works, the CAO's office, and a member, the director of planning for City of Angels.
For Clark, could you repeat the last?
The director of planning for City of Angels, David Hanham.
Thank you.
We narrowed it down to the top two. We interviewed the top two, and based on those interviews, David Evans and Associates was selected as the top consultant team. Staff negotiated with the consultant on the costs and services to be provided, and the results of those negotiations were before you today in the contract, and staff recommends this contract be approved.
Thank you. Are there any questions of Mr. Garcia?
You say you negotiated this price. What was the opening bid price when you opened the bid? How much did you negotiate?
The bids for the services ranged from,
this
direct answer, we negotiated about half.
About half?
Yes.
And you reduced the services provided? They reduced from their opening bid? Any?
We modified the services provided. We expressed our interest in dealing with the jail consultant. We expressed our interest in accelerating the process for one portion of the development, which would be the permanent access to the jail and the government center circulation, and as much of the improvements as we could get, which would be down to the bridge on Mountain Ranch Road. Those would appear to be the low-hanging fruit. From the bridge to Highway 49, widening Mountain Ranch Road and putting in some type of intersection improvements or looking at intersection improvements, right-of-way acquisition, those are all difficult, time-consuming tasks which would delay the entire project. We want to get from the bridge to the new jail and courthouse done, completed as fast as we can, and not hold up the jail construction or occupancy. This second portion, what we did, that's how we negotiated with them, is breaking off those two and then identifying the improvements that would be needed between Mountain Ranch Road, or between the bridge and Highway 49, and then that's what we're going to be going out and looking for additional funding on, because those improvements are expensive enough that it is worth it for us to go through the federal process for right-of-way acquisition, for intersection improvements, for the bridge widening, or the culvert widening.
So, let me get this straight. You changed the original scope from what they bid on from phase one to phase two, from a phase one and phase two, versus an overall project that they gave you an initial bid of, I'm thinking, $1.3 million? and then you negotiate it down into, okay, well, we just want this to be phase one from the bridge forward, this to be phase two?
No, we actually removed some of the services they were doing. They had proposed quite a bit of geotech services, coring of the road. We didn't think that was required. Mm-hmm. They had some additional consultant oversight that we didn't believe was required. We limited the services down to what we thought was necessary to build this project. But in that negotiation, we also clarified and condensed their focus, their efforts on two key portions of the project so that we would make delivery and they could work efficiently and keep the cost down. That's been our whole goal, is to keep the cost down on this.
All right. Thank you, Tom.
Are there any other questions, Mr. Garcia?
I have one. This is more general than specific, but this morning in one of the discussions or another, I can't even remember at this point which, the idea of breaking contracts up into pieces that local contractors can bid on based on their bonding capacity was brought up. And I know I'm getting a schooling in forest contracts right now, BLM and the U.S. Forest Service, and all the different ways that they put out stewardship contracts and agreements. And it does turn out there's a wide range of approaches, some of which allow local contractors are within their capacity, and some that they don't even qualify to bid on. And it makes all the difference who's employed and whether local economies are benefited by how those things are set up. So breaking up, for instance, a 10,000-acre piece into a number of different subsets of it actually becomes more on the ground capable for people here, and our contractors can qualify. Is there any such thing in these types of projects that we can do to encourage local employment and local contractor local contractors being qualified to do it?
We can look at that for the construction portion of this contract. I'm not. I'll have to work with, I guess, CAO's office and county council to find out what we can legally do as far as local preference or small business preference.
Well, that's one way to do it, but I think that our people are very qualified when they're able to have the size project that they're capable of doing, either by economies of scale or by meeting the bonding requirements. Sometimes the expense of bonding for a project is more than the small guy can pay, unless the project is smaller. So can you still, with an economy of scale of the large overall work, include the local people in the sub, break it up into its parts and still get benefit from it? Our local folks, for instance, usually don't cost as much, but they also don't qualify for as much. So how do you break out those pieces that local people can do and still be economically advantaged?
We'll take a look and see what we can do with the work with the consultant, see how we can incorporate those into how we can incorporate construction contracts, whether or not to split them up into smaller phases.
Hate to be on the outside looking in to when there is a local economy, and this is a big one. So
I think Mr. Evans discussed that last week when he went over the jail project.
Yes,
and
there was.
They broke out part of the road construction. Hopefully it can become local, even though it was going to cost more. Mr. Tuffinelli.
Yeah, Tom, I had a couple additional questions. I read the contract, very well written, very, very specific on it. The one item that I did run across, and I discussed it earlier with Jonathan, was it calls for only one public meeting, and that's prior. Can we get a second public meeting after the completion of the design phase?
I envision that the public meeting that we'll have will be for the portion of Mountain Ranch Road from the bridge out to the jail project. Mm-hmm. Most of our communication is going to be with the board in conjunction with the jail. When we get into the more difficult section between the bridge and Highway 49, we anticipate there's going to be a lot of public input on that.
The reason I bring it up is I noticed in this scope of work that there's a possibility of a roundabout being placed on Pope Street. It's in the documents. I read them. Okay. That's my concern to bring it to the public after the design, because if you read this, there's a possibility that it could be there.
It doesn't preclude looking at a roundabout, but again, we will be coming to the board for the approval of the project. So you'll have ample opportunity to weigh in on it prior to us. We will give you continuous updates on the project, and we will get direction from the board. I will check into adding additional public meetings.
I'm not real clear. Are you saying that you think that's the only option they're going
to have? No, I'm saying it's in there. The wordage is in there that the possibility exists. We would be looking at a roundabout on Pope Street. And I'm asking him, the contract calls for them to conduct one public meeting. And that's prior to the start of any designing. And I'm asking for them to have a second one after that, after it's complete, is what I'm asking for.
Okay. So people know what...
So-